breath. Heavenly Father, I can't imagine the pain that you felt offering your only Son for us who have sinned. He did not enter into glory until at first he suffered pain and was risen. Grant us that these days of Lent, we may be found going towards the cross, and we find truly the way of life to be that of peace. Sustain us, O God. Sustain us as we worship you on wings of joy through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the call for worship. Welcome, pilgrims, on our way to the cross.
We are willing to follow Jesus.
When Jesus says, go without telling us where our destination is.
Show us, Christ, how happy for our new way.
When rebirth is the impossible way forward.
Christ, the unending life, has been set Christ's call to do more.
When we find ourselves in between of where we are and where we've been and where we're going.
Christ leads us on the way and blesses us in going.
Pilgrims on the way, come let us worship God.
We come to worship God as we learn to live inside out. Amen.
And the first hymn is page 590. This is the day.
Worship Christ the Lord.
Please remember Eric. Give him help. Give him strength. Give him spiritual guidance, dear Lord. For S, Dottie, the mittens and the hands, let them know that you are there. Give them strength. Give Dottie the courage to be able to face the upcoming trials and tribulations. For Carol, George, John, and Dana, let them know that you are there. For Martha and Jim and Michael, for Jackie and Steve and the whole family that are still mourning the death of his brother and wife. For Barbara, keep her well. For Manny, for Bam, Pam, Ray, Carrie, and Sean. Heavenly Lord, keep all the kids that are going on spring break right now. Keep them safe. Bringing them back. For Amanda, Jimmy, the Conley family, and for Tom, give them guidance and strength. For Abby, give her comfort. And for Faye, for the loss for the Gonsalves family, for Diane and Mickey and Sherry, for Gail, Cole, Megan, and that family. You know their needs, dear Lord. Give them the strength. Give them the guidance. For Dana, Donna, Brenda, and Betsy. For Sandy, Jimmy, George, and AJ, and for Linda. For Bob, Jean, Jermaine, and for Zeb, Kathy, Marvel, the Marvel family, and for David. Lord, we offer these prayers to you, for your strength, for your guidance. Please hear their plea. Please join me now in the prayer that the Lord taught his disciples. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Chapter 6, verse 1 and 5 to 15, and from Mark, chapter 11, verses 24 to 25. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. And when you pray, do not do it like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like the pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, and as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. From Mark chapter 11, verse 24 to 25. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your sins. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
And if you'd like to join me singing, you can find the song on page 350 in the hymnal, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus.
Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, trusting alone in you, for you alone are the answer to all that we need. all that we could ever want, need, or desire. Father, before we even ask for those things, the promises are yes and amen to the glory of God. And so now in this sacred moment, I ask in the name of our Lord and Savior that you would fill us with your presence. Open our hearts and minds to receive your truth today and cause us to walk according to the path that you lead. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning, beloved. Welcome to Canterbury Chapel. My name is Pastor Warren Manigault. For those of you who don't know me, to our visitors, thank you for visiting this morning. Good to see you today. Those of us joining us on Facebook and social media, welcome to our service this morning. We're located at 381 South Main Street in Attleboro, where faith in Jesus Christ is our
foundation.
Praise God. All right. The subject of our message this morning is He Rewards the Heart, Part 2, with a subtitle of When You Pray. He rewards the heart when you pray. So, beloved, here we are, few days into our fast. It's only been 5 days, by the way. We started on March 1st. How you feeling? That's good. Now some of you look at me like, we started the fast? Yes, we did, by the way. Now, some of you may have not, arguably, some of you may have not started your fast yet. I recognize that, because if you're not doing the whole 40 days and you're doing 20 or some other modified version, I recognize that you may have started, not have started yet. But those of you who started, how you feeling? You feeling all right?
Yeah.
All right. You find yourself thinking more and more about what you want to eat, what you can't eat?
No.
No? Well, you can say okay. You can say yes, because I know I am. I'm thinking about it more and more. And what makes it more challenging for me is my wife and I aren't doing the same fast.
Oh.
Yeah, that's no fun at all, let me tell you. So she's literally eating all the things I'm not eating. She's getting right in my face. And I said to her the other day, really, you're going to eat chicken wings right in my face? Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. But it kind of reminded me of what Jesus said to John. Excuse me, said to Peter in John 21, when Peter had just been restored by Christ after he had remember Peter denied Christ 3 times. You know the story, right? So later after the resurrection, Jesus finds Peter fishing and he restores him and he tells him to feed his flock. And then right after God restores him, of course, Peter, you know, ever the interesting character, looks over at John and says, what about John? And Jesus says, what's it to you if I let John remain until I come again? As for you, you follow me. And so whatever it is that you've decided to do, whatever it is that you've decided to turn down or to fast, do what you were asked to do or do what the Lord asked you to do and let your spouse or whoever worry about what they're going to fast. Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
All right. Jesus was pointing to the reality of what it means to do a fast from the heart. For truly we know that God rewards the heart of what we do, not only in fasting, but also in prayer, which is what we're going to talk about today. The scripture says, and when you pray. So the assumption is that you pray, right? Because I can't say when you pray if you never pray, right? Now I'm certain if I ask that question to most of you here, you would say, oh yes, Pastor, I pray all the time. I pray every day. I pray 3 times a day even. But I hope you know I'm not talking about when you say grace over your food. That doesn't count, right? That's not really prayer like I mean. That's really a blessing. Amen?
Amen.
I'm speaking about those times when you expose your heart, when you expose your mind, when you are naked before a holy God who sees in secret, who sees your heart, the heart of man who knows what you think before you say it. When you are naked, exposed. Think of the relationship with a husband and wife. That first time when you came together, supposedly first time when you came together on your honeymoon, right? And you were naked and you were in front of each other, right? Hopefully, right? Don't look at me like that. Ain't nothing wrong with that, right? You were intimate with your spouse. You don't hide things from you. You don't hide your body. You don't hide your feelings. You don't hide what's going on in your thoughts from your spouse. This is what prayer is supposed to look like. Prayer is supposed to be when you expose your naked inner self to God. Because guess what? He already knows what's in your heart anyway. So you think you're hiding that secret, but he already knows the secret. But he wants you to see that he wants to help you with that very thing you're trying to hide from him. Because in each one of our lives, we have closets and shelves and cabinets, kind of like in our house. You know, don't open that drawer, things might fall out. Don't open that closet, watch out. There's places like that in our hearts. There are places like that in our minds that we don't want anybody to poke around in there. But those are the exact places that God wants to go to open wide so he can expose to you what's wrong with you. Amen?
Amen.
True prayer is naked, unashamed, unabashed, open and honest and real. That's why prayer can be not only words, but it can be your tears. Your prayer can be your tears. You remember the story about the woman in the Old Testament who wanted to have a child, and all she could do was weep before the altar. And the priest thought she was drunk. Woman, why are you drunk at 3 o'clock in the afternoon? She wasn't drunk. She was so overcome with emotion that she was weeping bitterly. Your prayer can be your tears. What about the woman who just washed Jesus' hair with her tears while she dried his feet with her hair? She said nothing. But Jesus heard her prayer. Prayers aren't always words, because prayer comes from the heart. Do you see that? Oh, well, you will in a minute. If you don't see it yet, you will in a minute. Amen?
Amen.
This, beloved, is true and genuine prayer. And it's the way we ought to pray when we pray. It's much deeper than blessing your food and laying, but now I lay me down to sleep, but bless mommy and daddy and doodle, etc. Let's look at our text in Matthew chapter 6. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, Jesus said, for they pray standing in the synagogue, or they pray standing on the street corner to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have their reward in full. When you do it for a show, when you do it so that man thinks, oh, look how holy and pious you are, you already have your reward because everybody thinks wonderful of you, whether or not it's true. Amen?
Amen.
In the older Greek term, in the older Greek phrase, hypocrite, right? A hypocritess, or hypocrite, which is where that word comes from, was an actor. Did you know that? In the Greek sense, a hypocrite was an actor. They were an actor who were playing a character. And in the first century, the term became known for those who played the roles on a stage. Someone who's a performer. Amen? So then a hypocrite is a person who falsely claims to live by a standard when you in fact do not live by that standard. Or when you are double standard, or you're double-minded, by the way. Or you're, what do we say today? Oh, I know, two-faced. Amen? Maybe today we would call those people politicians, all right? I'm sorry, I don't know how I did that. Forgive me, people. I don't want to get political now, all right? But I digress. But Jesus tells us not to be duplicitous in this way, especially when we approach God in prayer. Don't put on an act. Don't be a hypocrite. Don't act like, Father, who art in heaven? Is that really how you talk? Really? Dear Father, who art in heaven? If you talk like that, I wonder about you. Amen? In fact, Matthew 5:37 says what? It says, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Anything else is from the evil one. Meaning, don't put on a front. Don't put on a show. Don't pretend to be something that you're not. If you're struggling with sin, if you're struggling in your life, if you have a challenge that you have not overcome, be honest about it. Lord, I am messed up. I don't know what I'm doing as it relates to raising these children. I don't know what I'm going to do to get my next meal. I don't know how to make myself straight. I don't know how to put down these cigarettes. I don't know how to put down the alcohol or the marijuana or whatever it is that's binding you. Because guess what? He already knows that that's your problem. And he wants to help you get delivered. Amen?
Amen.
So don't be like the hypocrites. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues on the street corners. They love to be on the Grammys and on the American Music Awards and thank God and Jesus and everybody else because they're actors. Yes, sadly, beloved, we have a lot of people today who call themselves Christians, but they are hypocrites. They're actors, and we have a lot of them even in church fellowships as well. They're on Christian television, supposedly Christian musical artists. But when you examine the fruit of their life, beloved, and when you put the real questions to them and you put them to the test, They fail to answer these questions from a biblical worldview. They duck, they dodge, they sidestep, they politic the true questions of God because they don't want to lose fans or followers on Facebook and Instagram. These type of people and their prayers are actually an offense to God because they are done only to impress men, not the God of men. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. Let's continue in our text in Matthew 6, verse 6. But when you pray, who's he talking to? He's talking to the believers. He's talking to the disciples. Amen?
Amen.
But when we pray, when you pray, go into your inner room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen, so that your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you openly. We believers should understand that when we pray, we are meeting with a God in the inner room or the inner closet, which is our heart and our mind, where only God and us are. Where only God and you can talk. Where only God and you can see what's going on with me. Amen?
Amen.
A place of true intimacy, a place of true communion, a spiritual place. Not a place made with man's hands, but a place for God and God alone. For God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And that goes for prayer as well. Amen?
Amen.
You can't fake or act in your mind. You can't fake or act in your heart. And you can't hide your true thoughts and intentions from God. Remember what Jeremiah 17 verse 10 said, God searches the heart. He examines the mind to reward us according to what we deserve or what our reward should be. The specific Greek word, by the way, for room, that inner room I was talking about, was used for a storeroom where treasure is kept. That inner place, the place of treasure, the place of reward, that's what the inner room was. This reminds me that where your treasure is, then your heart will be also. Amen?
Amen?
For beloved, we know that that's where our treasure truly is, Matthew 6, 21 tells us. You see why Jesus said that when your Father sees what's done in secret will reward you openly? He's rewarding you in your heart and openly for the work that he's doing in your spirit. Whether or not you ever see it or someone else ever sees what's happening with you, the fact that God has met you in that secret place, has inspired you, has encouraged you, has lifted you, has strengthened you, you are able to receive a reward far beyond what you thought you could get. Amen? Because he rewards the heart. So when you pray, remember that. Look at verse 7 of our text. Do not keep babbling like the pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. When you hear that verse, I want you to picture a child that says, Daddy, 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 Mommy, 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 Mommy. Don't be like that. Your Father knows what you want before you open your mouth. Amen?
Amen.
Now, after a while, if your child said, Daddy, 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 you'd say, stop it! What's the matter with you? I heard you the first time. Fortunately, God has a lot more grace than we do. Amen? Pastor Warren, he's still working on me because I'd be yelling at him like that. Now, God may not say, you know, to hush, like I said, but he's looking at the heart of the human being and he's seeing what we need and he's telling us, don't be foolish in the way you approach me in prayer. I already know what you want before you ask me. So simply approach me like you got sense. God made us to be intelligent. Did you know that? God made us to be smart. To be wise. How come? Because that's what he is. We are his children. We're his offspring. He made us to be like him. God's not a fool and neither are we. Amen?
Amen.
You don't need to chant. or repeat ridiculous prayers over and over again. Okay, hold on to your wallets. Did you hear what I said? You don't need to chant and repeat prayers over and over again to get God's attention. Christian prayers are measured by weight, not by length. Many of the most prevailing prayers have been as short as they are strong. That's Spurgeon that said that. I can't take credit for that. The NIV translates the phrase vain repetition as babbling. It may be accurately translated from the Greek as batalagio, which is what it was in Greek, which is a word that sounds like babbling. So in a sense, it's almost like saying blah, 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 blah. When someone says blah, 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 do you hear that? What do you hear? You hear, sounds like nonsense, right? Hence, my illustration of mommy and daddy is apropos. Do you really want or think a prayer that sounds like blah, blah, blah is effective when it's just meaningless repetition? Reciting the Our Father, get ready, reciting the Our Father over and over again is completely unnecessary, as well as meaningless repetition. Since God is able to hear you the first time, and frankly, Our Father is not necessarily the prayer, but a model of prayer. The Our Father, the Lord's Prayer, is not necessarily a prayer. It is a model of how to pray. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. That's right, you heard me correctly. The Our Father is not necessarily a prayer at all, but a model of prayer, a model of how we as believers, as children of God, are to pray. Look at the text if you don't believe me, and let's look how Jesus spelled it out. There are five key elements. I wish you guys had notebooks and you were writing this down. There are five key elements found in the Our Father or the Lord's Prayer, such as it is often called. These elements are what we should find in any prayer we offer publicly or privately. Because make no mistake, Jesus was not suggesting that prayers may never be offered in public. Nay, beloved, he was simply teaching us how to pray effectively. The five elements we see in the Lord's Prayer are as follows. You ready? A close relationship. Number one, relationship. Number two, reverence. Number three, submission. Number four, trust. And number five, dependence. When you go home and you open your Bible and you look at the Lord's Prayer, I want you to see this model. I want you to see that there is a relationship, there is reverence, there is submission, there is trust and dependence. These are the elements of an effective prayer. Pastor, what are you talking about? They didn't teach me that in Catholic school. They didn't teach it to me in Catholic school either. Stay with me. All of this can be seen in the model of prayer Christ gave us. Let's dig in. Our Father in heaven is the right kind of prayer that comes to a God as Father in heaven. It rightly recognizes who we are praying to. We're not just praying to anybody. I ain't praying to Buddha or Confucius or Elijah, Muhammad, or some other God. I'm praying to our Father who is in heaven. And the fact that I call him Father suggests to you that that it's a privileged title. And it demonstrates that I have a privilege, here it is, relationship with God. It was very unusual for the Jews, by the way, of Jesus' day, to call God Father because it was considered to be too intimate. Remember what I said earlier about intimacy? Calling God their Father was considered to be too intimate. But this is exactly what God wants from us in prayer. He wants intimacy with us. We think, oh no, I can't call. No, God wants you to come so close to him that you can almost touch him. Amen?
Amen.
What do you mean, Pastor Warren? Well, let me tell you. My father, some of you know, some of you met, is Bishop G. Warren Manigault II. But that's not how I refer to him. I don't walk around saying, hello, Bishop G. Warren Manigault II. Father G. Warren Manigault II. Is that how I talk to him? Is that how I talk to my father, though?
No.
No. I simply call him Dad, or Daddy, or sometimes even Pop. Other than me, the only other person who calls him that is my sister, or my children, or my nephew. Why is that? Because we have, oh, by the way, and my wife will refer to him as that as well. Why? Because we have a personal, intimate relationship with him. Just like you should with your Heavenly Father. Amen?
Amen.
But God's not like our earthly parents. He's the eternal, living, life-sustaining God, creator of all the universe. Which is why we call him, or why we address him and say, hallowed, which is an old King James word for holy, is your name. Our Father who is in heaven. And then the next part is what? This is the second element, reverence. Holy is his name. Now let me tell you something. We've lost all respect in the 21st century. And I don't know what happened to it. Used to be when I was a kid, when an adult or the priest or a politician or a dignitary walked into the room, everybody stood up. It didn't matter if you liked the person or not. Didn't matter if you voted for him or not. The fact that they had a title and a position of governor, mayor, congressman, senator, teacher, pastor, priest, parent, coach, meant you gave them respect. Reverence. But we don't like that. We're too cool for that these days. But that's exactly the way we ought to approach God. Holy. He's not regular. He's not common. He's holy. Holy means that he's sacred, he's set apart, he's unique, there is nothing and no one like him. So we should not address him like we address everybody else. Used to be when you came to church, you didn't touch the things that were considered holy, like these things that are behind me. People wouldn't come and put their coffee on the sacred desk that I preach from every Sunday after service because, you know, they understood that this is the sacred desk where the word of God comes forth from. So it's treated with special reverence. We don't do that anymore, sadly. The second element is reverence. We reverence him, not as common, not as typical, but holy, separate, worthy of praise, worthy of honor, worthy of glory, worthy of our worship. And now that we recognize our need and responsibility to worship him, we begin to do what's the third element, which is we begin to submit. For there can be no real worship, beloved, without submission. Unless you submit to his way, his will, his desire, his plan, you're not really worshiping him. Did you know that? Submission is a heart thing. Anybody got a dog? Your dog might be sitting down, but in their heart, they're not submitted. They're ready to jump. You ever see a dog do that? They kind of sit down, but they're not really sitting. They're just partially sitting. And as soon as you turn your back, they're up again. True submission is from the heart. From the heart to the will, to the plan, the purpose of the sovereign God. His kingdom come. Your will be done on earth. That's submission, by the way. You hear that? Whose will be done? His will be done. Where? On earth. Where who is? Where we are. Where he is. Where he's in heaven. So we want what happens in your throne room, God, to happen right here for me. That means I'm submitted to your plan. I'm submitted to doing things your way. Amen?
Amen.
Beloved, now that we are submitted to what he is, to his will, and what he is able to do for us, not based on our divine plan, but his divine plan, beloved, in heaven and on earth. In faith, we request of God, demonstrating our trust, which is the fourth element, in him by saying, give us this day our daily bread. So first we established that we had a relationship, right? Then we established that we are reverent. Then we established what? That we were worshiping him and that we were honoring him and that we were submitted to him. And then once we have demonstrated those things, it's very simple, very easy to make our requests. Because we're in the room. We're in the throne room of God. Do you realize that your prayer, my God, I don't have time to preach this like I want to. Do you realize that your prayers usher you into the throne room of God? Do you know that? You're not in your bedroom or in your car or in Canterbury Chapel. You're in the very presence of God when you pray like this. I wish somebody was praying for me right now.
We are.
In faith, you make your requests to God, showing that you trust him, the fourth element, by saying, give us this day our daily bread. And oh, by the way, forgive us our sins, our debts, as we forgive those who sinned against us. In other words, provide for us, oh God, what we need to walk and obey your instructions and how we ought to live in this life, which is to trust in you, not in ourselves and not in our own abilities, but to trust in you, Lord, for our food, our livelihood, our sustenance, and to trust you to forgive us for falling short. That means our sins, by the way. And we are mindful to do the same for other children of God that you have made who also sin and fall short. Amen?
Amen.
Unless we forget element number 5. We not only trust and believe in you, Lord, but we recognize our utter dependence upon you to escape and avoid the snares and the trap of the enemy of our soul, because we are powerless without you. Which is why we pray, and do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Because after all, it's all your kingdom, and it's all your power, and it's all your glory forever. Amen. It is so. Beloved, this is how we ought to pray. Every day, in every situation, whether we pray in public or private. For we are offering prayers of faith from the heart that demonstrate that we are his children, the sheep of his pasture, and as such, we are fully in relationship, reverence, submission, trust, and dependent upon our heavenly Father. So when Jesus promised us in Mark 11:24, therefore, he said to us, when you ask for anything in prayer, believe that you receive it, and it'll be yours. That's why you can say that. I know when I go to my Father, and it's in his power to do something for me, he does it. Does it yours? But when you stand praying, if you have something against someone, see, sin, rebellion, strife, wickedness, fighting and bickering and gossiping and these things that tear down the unity of the faith, they get in the way of prayer. Did you know that? You have to let go of those things if you want God to truly bless you. You got to let God open that drawer and take out that spirit of unforgiveness that you have for your sibling or your parents or for those people that hurt you all those years ago. You got to let God open that closet of alcoholism. You got to let God open that closet of addiction. You got to let God into those places that you've been hiding from him so he can free you from the thing that's keeping you from intimate relationship with him. It's like a husband and a wife where one of them have committed adultery and they cannot be intimate. They cannot come together because one of them has a sin in the way. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. For beloved, God rewards the heart. And it includes, and it especially includes, when we pray. Do you want to have an intimate fellowship with your Father?
Amen.
I said, do you want to have an intimate relationship with your Father?
Yes.
Do you want to be in the throne room of God?
Yes.
Ask what you will in prayer. Believe that you have it and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven will forgive you your sins as well. For I tell you truly, when the Son of Man comes in all his glory, will he find faith in the earth. Amen.
Amen.
everybody's here. His heart was heavy because he knew where he was going. The disciples did not. He had been telling them all along that he had to lay down his life. But it was only until after Calvary and after he was resurrected that they fully understood the gospel. And that is this, that the Son of God would come, the Word made flesh, dwell among us, and give his body, which would be broken for us. His body was marred. The prophet said that he was beaten to the point that he was unrecognizable as being human. They ripped his beard from his face. They whipped him with many lashes. They put a crown of thorns on his head, a reed in his hand as a goofy scepter of royalty, and an itchy woolen robe upon his back to mimic the robe of a king. They didn't realize that they were making fun of the king of all creation. But the Bible said that it was God's good pleasure to crush him so that he could restore us to himself. The beating that Jesus took was designed to show us the horror that is sin. How God actually sees our sin. It's not a thing of beauty. It's an ugly, vile thing. And Jesus' crucifixion was meant to depict that. So as you eat this bread today, think about the fact that this is Jesus' broken body, broken for you, so that you can be healed. And it's done with one piece of bread, so that we understand that we all are one, even though we look like many.
Let us break bread together on our knees.
Please wait for me before you leave.
Let us break bread together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun,
Jesus took the cup. When he had given thanks, he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood." Again, I'm not sure they really understood what he meant. See, they had existed in the old covenant, which was, you follow a bunch of rules and regulations and procedures and traditions, and that gave you salvation, that gave you access to God. No longer was that to be the case, because the new covenant meant that the body and the blood of Jesus Christ would be our access point to the Father. No longer will we have to go to church on Saturday or Sunday. No longer do you have to wear a certain outfit. All these rules and regulations are man-made. God intended for us to come through the veil of the body and blood of Christ. The body of Christ that was broken for you, bruised for your iniquity, the chastisement of your peace fell upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. The blood of Christ that makes us family with God. The scripture says that the life of anything is in its blood. If I want to know whose family you belong to, I only need one drop of your blood, and I can test your DNA, and I know what family you belong to. I even know what part of the world you came from just by analyzing your blood. This blood makes us one with Christ and all believers in Christ, past, present, future, and for all eternity. Amen?
Amen.
So as you eat the bread and drink the cup today, remember that. Please eat the bread at this time. Please drink the blood of your redemption now. Father, I pray that this will not be a ritual today, but something that reminds us that we are one with you and you with us. Let us remember that, Father, as we are during this time of fasting during Lent. Stand fast, deacons. Stand fast. Deacons, stand fast. Stand fast. Let us remember, Father, that we are one. We don't just celebrate Lent. We don't just go through these things because of tradition. But we are doing these things because we want to be intimate with you. We want to be naked and unashamed. As you created us in the garden, they were naked and unashamed. Spiritually, Lord, that's the way we want to be with you. This church, Canterbury, that you've planted, and this community, Father, we will have that intimacy with you. And all around us will know that we are your disciples. Because we have love one for another, because we are one family. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Proceed, ministers. Thanks. You may be seated. Thank you. The toil and sweat of our brow. We were made to work, God, whether people realize it or not. For you created man to keep and to till the garden that you had planted in Eden. We were given a job before we were given a wife. Truly, we were meant to be working and created beings. And we were meant to produce. What I hold in my hand is an example of what we have produced. But Lord, we know that it is your life, breathing breath, and the water that you give us that breathes and wets things so that they grow and prosper and multiply. Multiply these gifts, most of all, so that they may be utilized for the spreading of the gospel. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, thank you. And be still, Lord. Amen. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth derives its name. I pray that of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with his power through his Spirit in your inner beings. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have the power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and how long and how high and how deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen.
Amen.
Now please stand with me and join me in our closing hymn. They'll know we are Christians by our love. Surprise. Actually, I might need a hymn for this one.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, we are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, and we pray that all unity may one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Don't y'all sound nice?
We are one with each other. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And we'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Last verse.
All our praise to the Father, from whom all things flow. And all praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son. And all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
May our God and Father in heaven bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. God bless you all, my fellow saints and believers. Have a great and wonderful day, and we'll see you all next time. God bless. Amen.
Amen.